Hello everyone and welcome to my channel. Today we're going to be looking into a story about an unfinished highway in the mountains of Los Angeles. And before you go jumping to conclusions and think that this is going to be some ridiculously boring story, this highway's purpose wasn't intended for the normal usage that you may be thinking of. Nope, instead it was intended to be a nuclear escape route for the people of Los Angeles in the event of a nuclear attack. Just before we jump into the story today, I do want to mention if you are interested in things like true crime, crazy historical events, ghost phenomena, and things of that sort, then you have stumbled on the right channel because that is all I'm going to be talking about every single week, and I'm even going to be traveling to and exploring most of the locations that I talk about on this channel. So definitely hit that subscribe button and stay tuned for more adventures. Today's series of events spans over quite a few decades, starting in the mid-40s and ending in the early 90s. Specifically, this era is referred to as the Cold War. However, we're not going to be focusing on every single decade. If you want to learn a little bit more about the Cold War itself and see a complete breakdown of the events over the decades, I'll go ahead and leave a link down below to some of the comprehensive timelines and other things that I used for my research. But for today's video, we are only going to be focusing on the first few decades. Historians have identified several causes that led to the outbreak of the Cold War, including tensions between the United States and the Soviet Union at the end of the Second World War, the ideological conflict between them, the emergence of nuclear weapons with a rapid speed, and ultimately just the fear of communism spreading throughout the world. The Cold War essentially started at the end of the Second World War after the surrender of Hitler's Germany on September 2nd, 1945, and after the United States dropped atomic bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. However, there were also articles that I read that said the war officially began 2 years later, on March 12, 1947. The war actually gets its name due to there being no direct military engagement between the United States and the Soviet Union. Instead, the fighting happened indirectly in third world countries such as Korea during the Korean War. After the atomic bomb was dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, Japan surrendered control of Korea, and at this time, the United States and Soviet Union agreed to split the country into two occupational zones. The north was occupied by the Soviets, who taught them how to form a communist government, while the south was occupied by the United States, where we oversaw elections and ensured a democratic government was formed. However, when the two withdrew from their respective parts of Korea, tension started to build till it finally erupted into war with the North invading the South in 1950, and this war lasted until 1953 when the two sides formed a truce of sorts and agreed to have a section of land between the two sectors, which formed a demilitarized zone. And this section would be kept as essentially a no man's land. Backtracking a tiny bit, in 1949, the Soviets conducted a successful test of a 20 kiloton bomb, and this was years ahead of what America believed they were capable of, which effectively started a nuclear arms race between the two superpowers. And by the end of 1952, the United States had begun tests of the first hydrogen bomb, on an island chain known as the Marshall Islands, which are situated about 3,000 miles west of the Hawaiian Islands, and the results vaporized the Marshall Islands, leaving a crater that was about a mile wide and over 160 feet deep. Completely devastating warfare, to say the least. By the mid-50s, fears of an imminent nuclear attack from the Soviets spread through the United States, and during this time and well into the 60s, schools would even practice drills known as the duck and cover drills, which are similar to earthquake or fire drills today, and this was in the event that a nuclear attack happened. My dad was actually telling me what he remembered from back then, and he recalled having weekly drills where you would have to get down to the ground and clutch your body like you do in the earthquake drill, which, if you ask me, this is a little bit redundant, because what is hiding under your desk and clutching your body going to do when this type of warfare can vaporize an entire island chain? But nonetheless, this was practiced from 1955 till 1969. On October 14th, 1962, an American U-2 spy plane, which was being piloted by Major Richard Heiser, was making a high-altitude pass over Cuba, and he photographed a Soviet SS-4 medium-range ballistic missile which was being assembled for installation on Cuba. And after President Kennedy was briefed on the situation on the 16th, he immediately ordered a naval blockade around Cuba, and what ensued over the next 13 days is known as the Cuban Missile Crisis. A few days later, on the 22nd, Kennedy addressed Americans, notifying them of the presence of the missiles, and explained his decision behind the blockade. And he also ensured that the American people knew that the U.S. was prepared to use military force, if necessary, to neutralize this threat to national security.
This offensive buildup, a strict quarantine on all offensive military equipment under shipment to Cuba is being initiated. All ships of any kind bound for Cuba, from whatever nation or port, where they're found to contain cargoes of offensive weapons, be turned back. It shall be the policy of this nation to regard any nuclear missile launched from Cuba against any nation in the Western Hemisphere as an attack by the Soviet Union on the United States, requiring a full retaliatory response upon the Soviet Union.
Finally, on October 28th, after lots of exchange tensions, the Soviet leader, Nikita Khrushchev, sent two letters to President Kennedy. In the first one, he offered to remove the missiles in exchange for the promise by the United States leaders not to invade Cuba. And the second proposed that the United States also remove their missile installations in Turkey. Officially, the Kennedy administration accepted the terms in the first letter and just flat out ignored the second one. However, privately, American officials also agreed to the terms in the second letter, and the crisis immediately came to a close after this. A couple of things also started popping up around Los Angeles in the late 50s as well, such as fallout shelters throughout the city, which would be built in factories or even in people's basements. And some would be marked with signs, which could be accessed by anyone who was in the vicinity in that time of need. Most fallout shelters were comprised of metal windowless walls and were equipped with things like air and water filtration systems and enough food to last at least 2 weeks. At the same time, another form of defense was also being constructed by the city of Los Angeles, just east of downtown, a nuclear escape route. Construction of the highway began in 1956 in the San Gabriel Mountains, which is just above Azusa, California, and this is a city that's on the outskirts of Los Angeles County. Although the road was never completed and never even used once for any purpose, there are a few names that locals give it, such as Armageddon Highway, Road to Nowhere, or Convict Road, and this is due to majority of the construction of the highway being completed by prisoners. And then I also found some articles that suggested the name Convict Road comes from the amount of escaped convicts that called the San Gabriel Mountains their home or hiding place, but most just referred to them as the intended purpose, and that's the nuclear escape tunnels. Construction was expected to take 23 years, and most reports state that the road was expected to filter out into the Mojave Desert, which is roughly 200 miles away, and other reports state that it was going to end somewhere in Nevada, which is just a little bit past the Mojave Desert. The completed portion spans just under 5 miles, winding through the canyons of the mountain, and as the name suggests, there are two tunnels situated along the route. The first tunnel was completed in 1961, and stretches about 400 yards through the mountainside, and the second tunnel was completed a few years later in 1964, and this one stretches about half the length of the first at only 250 yards. The construction continued until 1969, but only half a mile was completed between that 5-year period from the second tunnel to where the road just abruptly ends. Walking through the tunnels was really cool though. The second one was actually not even finished. There was piping along the walls, and you could even see that the walls were reinforced from some of the rock from the exploded part of the canyon. We even got dive bombed by a bat in the second tunnel. For years after this, the road sat completely abandoned and essentially forgotten about while America slowly moved away from the fear of a possible nuclear attack. And in 1984, the road gained wilderness status and was opened to the public shortly after as a hiking trail. The Cold War continued well through the 70s and 80s, and although the scare of a nuclear attack wasn't as rampant in these later years, the war didn't officially end until December 26, 1991, after the Soviet Union had collapsed a few days before. Tons of iconic images leading up to this moment signified that the war was coming to an end, such as the tearing down of the Berlin Wall in 89, which was a major historical moment in the thwarting of communism spreading throughout Europe. The nuclear escape route sits nearly forgotten and forsaken, really only traveled by adventure seekers and avid hikers, some of which don't even know the sordid history that this road holds. If you're interested in going on this hike, definitely try to avoid summer days, as there's little to no shade along the road, except for the sporadic tree or the tunnels. However, my husband, dog, and I actually went in the last 3 hours of the afternoon, and it was perfect. Not too hot, and there was even a breeze that went through the canyon, and the sunset was absolutely beautiful. It is quite a drive up into the mountains, though. It was something like 23 miles into the San Gabriel Mountains, twisting around beautiful scenery, and there's even a giant dam that you pass by when you're driving, but definitely the drive is breathtaking. There are also some secret tunnels, although I was only able to find one of them, and it was terrifyingly dark, so I noped it out of there pretty quickly, and naturally my camera stopped recording when I got to the tunnel. I think I turned on my flashlight or something and it just stopped recording, but the flashlight honestly didn't even work. It couldn't even penetrate a couple inches of the darkness. Anyways, I will put some of that info in the description below, and maybe you'll be able to find the secret tunnel that I was not able to. Today, the tunnels have become an artist's canvas of sorts, similarly to the remaining Murphy's Ranch architecture, and has graffiti covering all of the tunnel walls. The views of the hike are definitely well worth the trek as well. And to find this trail, you can search a couple different things and it gets you to the same place. So I'll be putting that down in the description below if you are interested in checking it out. But other than that, I am going to be wrapping up today's video right here. If you learned something new today, go ahead and put a like down below. And don't forget to subscribe to my channel if you are interested in learning about some of the lesser known true crime stories and historical events. And definitely hit that bell icon so you can get notified when I make a post. Especially right now with my channel being so new, YouTube isn't really recommending my videos quite yet, so hitting that bell icon really helps keep you in the loop, and honestly any interaction with this video is helpful to get my video put out on those recommended pages. But I really appreciate all of your support, and I hope that you are safe if you do choose to go on this hike, and I can't wait to talk to you all next week.